Life is like a mountain railroad with an engineer that's brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch for curves and hills and valleys. Never falter, never fail. Keep your hands upon the throttle and your eyes upon the rail. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach that blissful shore where the angels wait to join us in God's grace forevermore. As you row across the trestle, spanning Jordan, spell and tide, you behold the Union Depot, into which your train will glide. There you'll meet the superintendent, God the Father, God the Son, with a hearty, joyous greeting. Merry pilgrim, welcome home. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach that blissful shore where the angels wait to join us in God's praise forevermore. In God's praise forevermore.
Amen.
All right.
Seems like these songs are about heaven this morning. First thing I'm going to do when I get there is just shout. Amen. I don't care who's around me. You know, if you're a quiet person, you might want to just get out of the way. But I'm going to shout. Amen. There be shouting on the hills of glory. Shouting on the hills. Shouting on the hills, there be shouting on the hills of glory. There be shouting on the hills of God. Oh, what a blessed reunion. Oh, what a blessed reunion. When we gather over yonder, there be shouting on the hills of God. There be shouting on the hills of glory. Shouting on the hills, shouting on the hills. There be shouting on the hills of glory. There be shouting on the hills of God. Sorrow in the city, no more sorrow in the city. Jesus prepared a place in heaven. There be shouting on the hills of God. There be shouting on the hills of glory. Shouting on the hills, shouting on the hills. There be shouting on the hills of glory. Hear me shouting on the hills of God.
time to make your preparation. Now's the time to make your preparation. Stop and make your reservation. There be shouting on the hills of God. There be shouting on the hills of glory. Shouting on the hills, shouting on the hills. There be shouting on the hills of glory. There be shouting on the hills of God. There be shouting on the hills of God.
Well, there's only one way to get there, folks, and that's through Jesus. Amen.
I'm in the way, the bright and shining way. I'm in the glory land way. Telling the world that Jesus saves today. I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Gospel call today, head in the glory land way. Wanderers come home, oh, hasten to obey, get in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is near and the way groweth clearer. Rejoicing in His love, I'm in the glory land way. Soon I shall see Him in the home above. I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is nearer and the way groweth clearer. For I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is nearer and the way groweth nearer. For I'm in the glory land way.
Amen. Well, amen and glory to His name. I want you to sing with me this morning.
The cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name.
Amen. I want you to stand with me. We're going to sing that little chorus. It's easy. You know it. Yeah. Isn't he wonderful? Amen.
Yes, he is.
Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, 'tis recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Now sing it like you mean it. Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, 'tis recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful?
You know, does anybody know what today is? It is Flag Day. And I want you to know I took the little flags that we normally put out on the driveway and I tried to put them in the ground. You know, we either get a flood of rain that the ground is so soft you could just mush down all in it, or you can't drive a nail in it out there. And I broke two of the sticks today trying to put the flags and I just gave up. But you know what, ladies and gentlemen? I tell you, it breaks my heart as an American that is so proud to live in this country today and so thankful for the sacrifices that have been made that we have the opportunity to have these freedoms here today.
Amen.
To be here to worship our God and our King. Amen.
Amen.
And I'm thankful for every life that's been given for this flag. I'm thankful for every veteran, man or woman that's ever gone to the battlefield, ever enlisted in the Army, ever been drafted, ever been anywhere wearing uniform.
Yes.
Thank God for you today, and I appreciate you, and I thank God for this flag, and I think it would only be proper if we stood up today, and let's say the Pledge of Allegiance today. Brother, would you lead us today, and I'll hold the flag. We'll say the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Amen. Thank you so much. All right. Can we sing a little song or something? Just
okay. How about we, Brother Dwayne, let's go back and we'll do that last verse on standing on the promises. How's that? Amen.
Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing.
Thank you, Brother Ray. Nobody knew that I was going to do that today with the flag, and thank you for helping out. So, amen. Brother Dan and I is going to sing a song we like to do. It's called Voice of My Savior.
I heard a sweet voice so tenderly calling, saying, arise, be saved evermore. I knew it must be the voice of my Savior, for I had not heard a voice like it before. I remember one night in an old-fashioned meeting, I was praying to God to redeem my poor soul, when I heard a sweet voice so tenderly calling. I started that night to make heaven my home. I heard a sweet voice so tenderly calling, saying, arise, be saved evermore. I knew it must be the voice of my Savior,
for I had not heard a voice like it before. So glad that I heard the voice of my Savior. I know I'm redeemed by His wonderful grace. Someday when He calls, I'll meet Him in heaven. And then in that city, I'll look on His face. I heard a sweet voice so tenderly calling, saying, arise, be saved evermore. I knew it must be the voice of my Savior, for I had not heard a voice like it before. For I had not heard a voice like it Bibles, you want to open them up to the book of John, chapter number 11 and 12. That's what we're going to look at today. There we go. John chapter 11 and 12. I was just thinking, Brother Dwayne, number one's a little too hot for me, please. Thank you. I was just thinking while we were singing that song and Miss Lawson started shouting, the thoughts ran through my mind about when I asked my mom. I said, Mom, tell me about when you got saved. And she told me she was just a little girl in a revival meeting when she got saved. And then some time later, she got baptized, and talking about my grandfather just shouting all over the place. And then the story about my grandfather. He had been attending a revival meeting that had been going on for a number of days, and he kept going and just, you know, was not motivated to know the Lord. And one night he went, and the Lord began to speak to his heart. And on the way back home, he knelt down on the side of a mountain and asked the Lord to come into his life and save him. And man, I thank God that, you know, I've been blessed to know those stories today. And I think about your story, Miss Lawson, when you got saved and your daddy asked you what was wrong with you, and you said you got saved. Amen. Well, I'll tell you what, we all got a story. Amen. And that song, Voice of My Savior, it is a very true story of me. The night that I got saved, I was in a tent revival meeting and knew the Lord was speaking to me that night. And I'm so glad that God spoke to my heart. I'm so glad I had the right response, amen, to trust Him as Lord and Savior today. If you're saved, why, you ought to be smiling, amen, and being happy about what I just said, because it ought to make you think about when you got saved, amen. And, you know, we can have terrible, gloomy, awful, terrible, tragic days in this life, but there's one thing that we always have in our life, and that is our salvation, amen? It is our solid rock, and I'm so thankful today that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is not changing. He still loves us no matter what, amen? And He loves us on our worst day. Thank God for that, amen? All right. Well, that wasn't a message, but that might be part of it, amen? In John chapter 11 and verse number 25, Jesus is standing at the tomb of Lazarus. He's getting ready to raise him up. And he says to Martha, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall what?
Never die.
Amen. Believest thou this? Did you believe that today? That's the question. Amen. And verse number 43, and Jesus had just got through praying. And then in verse number 43, and when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Amen. And brother, what happened? Lazarus came forth, and Jesus said, loose him and let him go. Amen. Now, I want you to go over to John chapter 12 with me, if you will. Some things are going on now after this resurrection of Lazarus. Jesus is at Bethany, and he has ridden into Jerusalem on the donkey. And verse number 18,
verse number 17, the people therefore that was with him when he called Lazarus out of the grave and raised him from the dead bear record. In other words, they were witnesses to what Jesus had done. He had raised Lazarus from the dead. Verse 18, for this cause the people also met him, for they heard that he had done this miracle. The Pharisees therefore said amongst themselves, perceive ye how ye prevail nothing? Behold, the world has gone after him. And that's my message today. The world has gone after him. Let's bow our hearts for a moment. Father, thank you again, Lord, for meeting with us. Lord, I just ask you, Lord, that you would just right now, just God, just take over this service. I pray you place every word in my mouth today for whatever our hearts need today. I pray, Father, that we would be ministered to, that Jesus would be lifted up and magnified above all names. Holy Spirit, speak to hearts today. Speak to those that might be lost today. Speak to the Christian, Lord, that might be in bondage of some sort today. And God, I pray that we would leave this place different than what we came in today. Lord, have your way now, we pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Well, John 12:19 says, behold, the world has gone after him. The place is Bethany. And the Bible says this is where Lazarus, whom Jesus had raised from the dead, was. The chapter opens in chapter 12 with Mary anointing the feet of Jesus. You remember that story. And Judas is there and he starts complaining, why didn't we sell this ointment for all the money that it's worth and put that into the treasury? And also within that story, the Bible says that much people of the Jews, they knew Jesus was there and they assembled there to see him, but they also wanted to see this man who had been dead at one time but was now risen. They all came to see what was going on, amen? You know what? I have learned this, that if that happened today, if somebody had been risen from the dead, there'd be people running up and say, can you tell me what it was like being 23 minutes in hell? Can you tell me what heaven was really like? See, that's what you get today, amen. But I digress. Let's get back to the story. The next day, Jesus makes his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And the people are happy to see him. You remember that story? They're laying palm leaves down at his feet and they're saying, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. Now, the Pharisees are there and they're all upset. They're sitting there and they're upset because in the audience, they see this man that's named Lazarus that's been resurrected from the dead. And there's many witnesses there to verify the story to make it true. I mean, they cannot deny of what has happened. So, this is just too much for the Pharisees to accept. You see, their religion was the law, and the law could not resurrect a man. Did you think about that? The law was their religion, but it couldn't resurrect a man. It could only judge him, and that's why it's called the ministry of death. Amen? I hope that you read your Bibles, and I hope that you start finding some of these phrases that I'm talking about. The old covenant law in the New Testament is called the ministry of death. Yeah. You know why that is? Because, buddy, when you messed up, what did that mean? Death. Amen? That's why it's called the ministry of death. Now, the thought ran through my mind the other day, and this is really sad, but, you know, there's been a number of people that's come here, and they hear me preach or Brother Ray preach maybe one or two times, and then they scat out those doors and they never come back again because they think that grace preachers and teachers have gone off our rocker when we say things like the Ten Commandments was just for Israel only and not the Gentile. They think we're off our rocker. But you see, the sad part of it is they don't come back to hear the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey used to say, and really the best part of the story, because what we really teach and what we really preach is the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Amen? That's the story of grace. Amen? It's kind of like these Pharisees. They like their law and they're masters of the law, but they, you know what? Even though they were doctors and masters of the law, they failed to see the Messiah who was sitting just before them. And they failed to understand his miracles that he had done by raising a man from the dead. That's huge, amen, when you raise a man from the dead. Yeah. A resurrected man is sitting before them and they have hate in their hearts and they despise what they are witnessing. The chief priests and the Pharisees, they begin to consult one with another. And they say, how can we kill Jesus and Lazarus? Let's get rid of this man. Yeah. Because of him raising a dead man back to life, look what's happening. The Jews are believing on him. This was their fear. They're afraid that the Jews are going to hear and follow Jesus. Amen? So I got to wondering, though, about Jesus' last miracles before he went to the cross. And you know what? There's two of them just before he goes to the cross. And you might think that raising Lazarus was probably the last one, but it's not. You see, when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and the soldiers came to get him, Peter took his sword out and he cut the ear off of one of those Roman soldiers named Malchus. And Jesus knelt down, picked that ear up, and stuck it right back on his head. That was a miracle, amen? But just before that, he had raised Lazarus from the dead. And I was working on this message and it just seemed like the Holy Spirit wanted me to see something here. And maybe it doesn't mean anything to you, but you know what? Jesus has the power to resurrect a man back to life. He has given us ears to hear what the Spirit had to say. Amen? And we ought to put the ears on this morning and hear what the Spirit has to say. Amen? Amen. So the Pharisees, they're watching what's going on and they begin to murmur among themselves and they say, "Perceive ye how ye prevail nothing?" Now in plain English, what this means is they're saying this: there's nothing we can do. The world has gone after him. They did not like seeing the Jews going after Jesus. So I hope today that we can see just how powerful the resurrection of Jesus is. Amen? The power of the resurrection of Jesus was the greatest fear of Satan. Because unlike the law, which is the ministry of death, Jesus has the ministry of life. Amen? Glory to God. Jesus died on the cross and took sin away. He became sin that we might become the righteousness of God in him. But just think what would happen if Jesus had not risen from the dead. That would mean that God the Father would not have approved his sacrifice. But glory to the Lamb of God, ladies and gentlemen. God the Father was satisfied with the finished work of his Son, Jesus. And because he was satisfied with that, he rose him from the dead. Amen. Can you understand now what the spirit of the Pharisees was all about? They did not want the Jews believing in Jesus because they were jealous and they were mad that Lazarus was sitting there, and because there was a lot of other witnesses there to be witnesses about this man's resurrection. The power of the resurrection is the greatest threat and the greatest defeat the devil has ever had. Amen. Because of the resurrection of Jesus, this means that Jesus is the Son of God. Amen. Glory to God, folks. We ought to be happy today that we can shout it from the rooftops that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead and Jesus is the Son of God. I was talking to my neighbor just this week, and thank God I've got some new neighbors, and turns out that they all love the Lord. Amen. And so we were just talking, conversing back and forth, and got to talking about the shape that America is in today. Day and people are kneeling and doing all kinds of things, and we both agreed together, we're glad that we have knelt before Jesus. Amen. And I put a little icing on the cake by that, by saying I'm glad I've knelt to Jesus in this life. Amen. Because listen to me, there'll be a day and a time that every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus is Lord, and that Jesus is King. Amen. And brother, I'm glad that I have knelt in this life and proclaim that Jesus is Lord. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. I can't wait to get to heaven someday to see his beautiful face and say, "Jesus, you are Lord. You are King of Kings." Amen. Glory to God. I'm glad I know the Savior today. You ought to be glad you know the Savior today too. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, I tell you, folks, I'm glad that I've acted like a Jew this morning. I've gone after him, amen. I'm going after him. I'm pursuing him today. Oh, the Pharisees were upset, and their greatest fear was that the world, as they knew it, would go after him. Praise God. Oh, I tell you, folks, they were upset. The resurrection of Jesus means that he is the Son of God. Romans chapter 1 verses 3 and 4. Jesus was the seed of David and declared to be the Son of God with power. Amen. According to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. God put his stamp of approval on Jesus that everything he said about him is true. He was the light of the world. He was the resurrection and the life. He was Emmanuel, God with us.
The resurrection validates who Jesus is. Glory to God. Brother Ayer, we don't need to kneel to nobody but Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the King and the King of glory. The resurrection is proof that the cross worked. Amen. All your sins, all of my sins that were against us, brother, have been nailed to the tree. Amen. Glory to God. There's nothing to be held against us anymore. We are without condemnation now because we have believed in the only begotten Son of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Our sins have been taken away. And you and I, ladies and gentlemen, that believe upon His name, we are forgiven people. 1 Corinthians 15:7 teaches us that if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain and you are yet in your sins. Well, glory to God. I want to tell you something. He rose from the dead. My faith is not vain and I am no longer in my sins. Amen. This verse, by the way, is the heart and soul of Christianity. If Jesus is not raised, we have no faith. The resurrection and the substance, the resurrection is the substance of our faith. Can you see why that this would upset the Pharisees? If the Jews are believing this, guess what? They'll have faith. And guess what? When you got faith, guess what? Guess what? Would you just say what?
What?
You'll depart from the law. Amen. That's what they were afraid of. The Jews was going to depart from the law. And you know what? There's a lot of people today that are walking around with a law-based life in their spiritual life. And if you'll have faith and just see what Jesus did and understand what it means that it is finished, you'll give up that way of living and you'll just walk in freedom and in liberty of Jesus. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. That's where I want to live. Brother, I've lived on the other side way too long. Amen. And just a few years ago, I began to learn about what my liberties are like, what my freedom is like, what Jesus did for me. Where I'm at in Him. In Him. In Him. I'm not outside of Jesus trying to work and catch up to Him. I am in Him. As a believer, you're in Him. Amen. Hallelujah. If you're listening today and you're not a born-again believer, let me just tell you something. You need to understand this. The last thing Satan wants you to do is to have saving faith in Jesus Christ. The last thing he wants is for you to believe in the resurrection of Jesus and go after Him. But if you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and will believe in your heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, the Bible says you shall be saved. Amen. If Jesus had not risen from the dead, we would have to delete this verse out of our Bibles. But dear friend, the Son of God indeed is risen. Amen. Well, hallelujah. You said, what?
Come on.
Well, we had to miss Easter, so this is the resurrection story. Amen. Amen. Brother, I tell you something. This ought to be the message every Sunday in every church, glory to God, that Jesus has risen from the dead. Amen. That's why we're here. When God called Abraham to sacrifice Isaac, Abraham reasoned that God had power to bring Isaac back to life. Isaac was the son of promise. This meant that through him and through Abraham that Jesus was going to come. Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. So what is it that Abraham believed about God? He believed that God had power to give life to the dead. Amen. And when Jesus went to the tomb of Lazarus, guess what happened? He proved it. Amen. Amen. He proved it. And guess what, ladies and can I hear you say what?
What?
We all believe the same thing about Jesus. Amen. That he has power to give life today.
Amen.
If you're out there listening today, and you're walking in spiritual darkness, you don't know Jesus Christ, you want life. I know you want life. Nobody wants to have death and die. Nobody wants to just die. You want life. And I'm telling you, where life is today, it's in Jesus Christ. Amen. Glory to God. When the Pharisees, when they saw the multitude going after Jesus, they were upset and they wanted to destroy Him. You know what? Today, there's a lot of forces that hate what we believe about Jesus. Amen. There's a lot of forces that hate what we believe about Jesus. I tell you, this might surprise you, but you know what? Religion hates Jesus. You know why religion hates Jesus? Because religion is all about itself. Religion is about what I can do to be in favor with God. Religion is about what I've done to be in favor with God. Religion says God needs to accept me. Religion says God needs me. Religion will send you to hell. Amen. There's political views that hate the message of the resurrection. I think that's pretty obvious more today than I've ever seen in my lifetime.
They hate Jesus Christ because believers from all over are going after Him. Amen?
Yeah.
I'm glad to be going after Him today. And it's because we believe that He is the Son of God. The resurrection of Jesus means that we have life. Glory to God. John 10:10 says, "The thief comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. But Jesus said, I'm come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." Amen. Believing upon Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection brings life to us. We actually receive the life of Jesus in us. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that remarkable? Isn't that astounding? Isn't that amazing? How else can you describe this, that you actually have, as a born-again believer, you have the very life of God living in you?
Yeah.
That's amazing to me. That God, from eons of time ago, way back in eternity past, how long has eternity been around? Well, it's been around for a long time, amen. But you know, even way back in eternity past, billions of years before you was even conceived in your mother's womb, God knew about you. And He knew about me. And God had a plan for you. And He had a plan for me. Amen. And He wanted to give us life. And He wanted to give us life that's abundant. Amen. And He wanted to share His very life in and through us. Man, that blows me away. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God has made us His righteousness in Jesus. Amen. Ask yourself this question today. Can Jesus ever die since He's been resurrected? Would you answer that question for me today? Can Jesus ever die since He's been resurrected?
No.
Amen. So the answer is no. Since we have His very life in us, can we die spiritually again? It's the same answer, folks. We once were dead in sin, but now we are dead to sin. We have resurrection life in us, and we shall never, ever, ever, never, ever, never, ever, ever, never, ever die. Amen. I'm glad to be alive today. I am living my eternal life right now because it's the eternal Spirit of the living God living in me today. And if you're a born-again believer, that's where you're at. We should just enjoy eternity together. Amen. Brother, you need to start getting along with me. Amen. Oh, He loves me. He always gets along with it. He hugs my neck and kisses my neck sometimes because He loves me so much. I'm serious when I said that. Amen. Brother, I tell you something. We ought to learn to be loving on each other, amen, in this life, because we're going to spend eternity together sometime, amen, in heaven. We'll have a new address, amen. Our life. We have the resurrection life in us, and we shall never die because. Let me hear you say because. Because our life is hid in Christ, and it's not based on how we act. Amen.
Amen.
And I know some of you like to act up in here. You ought to be glad that you're hid in Jesus.
Yes.
Man, you know what that means to me? Boy, I tell you, when the devil comes looking for me, I know he's in here somewhere. He's got to go through Jesus, and that ain't ever going to happen, folks.
Yeah.
I'm hid. I am secure. I'm alive forevermore in Jesus today. Amen. Perfectly made by Him today. Made alive. I tell you, folks, we have gone after Him as believers. We have life in Him. We have the promise of eternal life. It is life that is abundant. You know what happened? When the devil came to the garden, he stole from Adam. The enemy went to the garden and he went there to destroy. And the enemy accomplished spiritual death to all of those who are still in Adam today. But the Lion of Judah showed up one day, folks. The ever-present one came to us. The giver of life rescued us. He is Jehovah Tiskanu. That means the Lord, our righteousness, has made us righteous. Amen. Some of you thought I was speaking in tongues, didn't you? I just gave you a name of Jesus. Amen. Jehovah Tiskanu. I guess that's how you pronounce it. But the Pharisees, they were very good in their law. They knew the story of Abraham and Isaac. They knew the faith of Abraham, that he knew God would give life. And if Jesus was who he claimed that he would be, their fear, their greatest fear was that their ministry was going to come to an end. And now they want to kill him because the world, as they knew it, had gone after him. To go after him is quite a statement.
It is quite a statement. So what does that mean to go after him? Well, when I was studying this, the Holy Spirit said, look up the word gone. So I looked it up. Some people say gone. So there's two definitions. Gone is they're gone away. Gone means they're gone away. But gone has the meaning of to go away. But there's another definition that I saw, and I like this. I'd like to share it with you. It means to be soon passing out of sight. To be soon be passing out of sight, passing from memory or existence, quickly fading or disappearing. When I read that thought, thinking about those Pharisees, that they were upset that the Jews would go after Jesus' teaching and leave the life that they were living under their law, and they would forget about the temple and the sacrifices if Jesus was really who he claimed to be. That was their fear. Did you know, Mr. and Mrs. Believer, that that is exactly what Satan is most fearful of you doing? He wants you to base your spiritual life on what performances you can do on a daily basis. Listen to me. He wants to trick you into reading your Bible as a duty. Let's just pause right there so I want that to soak in. He wants to trick you into reading your Bible daily as a duty instead of just enjoying the voice of God through the Scriptures. Yeah. He wants to trick you into praying with a regiment instead of just going through the day having conversation with the Father.
Yeah. Amen.
He wants to trick you into hitting all your quotas for witnessing today instead of just living life and letting Jesus live his life in and through you. And when the Holy Spirit opens opportunity, then you get to share him with a smile on your face and with a joy and with an excitement instead of like, what a burger just done today.
Yeah.
There's a big difference, let me tell you. You know why I can speak so boldly about this? Because I used to live that way.
Yeah.
It was a duty to read. It was a duty to pray. It was a duty to witness. Jesus said he came to get life more abundantly.
Yeah.
Buddy, when you're living the abundant life, man, there's the Bible. I think I'll read the Bible today and see what God has to say. Oh, Lord, thank you for showing me that today. Amen!
Yeah.
Glory to God, folks. We got a mighty, mighty awesome God who loves us, and he doesn't want you to ever feel the sense of duty. I've heard messages preached on duty. Jesus wants us to live the abundant life. Enjoy him. Enjoy him in this life. Get ready for that next life. Amen. Glory to God. So, the devil is afraid for you to just enjoy Jesus. The enemy understands that if you get free in Christ, the life of law-based living, listen to me, it goes to our definition, the life of law-based living will fade and disappear from your spiritual life, and you just might begin to grow in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Now listen, if you don't want to understand what I just said, if that sounds confusing or controversial to you, send me an email. Or get with me after the service today. I'd be glad to talk to you. I'm serious. Because I know that's controversial, what I just said to a lot of people. But listen to me. We need to understand that Paul, the Apostle Paul, dealt with people who were trapped in a performance lifestyle after they got saved. Galatians 3:1 says, O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? And then verse 3 says, are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, that you now made perfect by the flesh? Do you understand what he's saying? These people got saved and now they think, well, let's just go back to law-based living. Let's keep the Ten Commandments. Let's blah, 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 blah. You know, just whatever you can dream up. That's what you want. These are the rules and regulations we live by. Oh, Jesus saved us. That's great. But wait a minute. Paul says, are you so foolish to think that after you got saved by faith through him that you can start living under law now? That's foolishness. Don't go back to that. Listen,
When the Christian is more concerned about daily performances than the truth of being set free once and for all, he will always be in question of his or her right relationship with God.
Amen. If you're basing your life on how good you are today, or you did good today, or I'm going to do better tomorrow, if that's the way that you're praying, God, help me to do better tomorrow, help me to do better today, help me to stop messing up, and then you grade yourself at the end of the day, I did pretty good today. I didn't cuss, I didn't look at women, I didn't look at men, I didn't. You start grading yourself, that is performance-based living, and you are surely bound to fail.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is about Jesus and nothing else. If Satan can keep you refusing to accept the message of the gospel of grace, he'll be satisfied for you to stay in spiritual bondage, constantly worrying about if you're doing enough. Now listen, I don't think it's good, and I don't see how people do it. This is just my personal viewpoint now. When I got saved, you know what I wanted to do? I wanted to go tell people. And I did. I told all my teenage friends. I took them all out one at a time, driving around the block. I told them, man, I got saved. And I'm going to serve the Lord. I had this zeal in me. I'm not saying everybody's like me, but I just wanted to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. I just did. And I just had a desire. I wanted to go to church. I wanted to be around men of God. I wanted to hear the word preached. I couldn't wait to go to Sunday school class. That was just me. I'm not saying everybody's like me. But man, I tell you something, when God moves into your life, there's some things that ought to excite you. Amen? Wow. I tell you what, the Pharisees, they were learned men who knew the law and prophecies concerning Messiah. They believed that when Messiah would come, listen, this is what their expectations were, that Jesus was going to do away with the law and replace it with a new set of rules and ordinances. That's what they were all about. But Jesus corrected them and taught them when Messiah would come, all the law would be fulfilled in him. Jesus was not teaching what they believed, and they were dismayed at him.
Yeah.
Buddy, when you're teaching things that people don't believe, they become disfigured in their face and they get dismayed. I've noticed mainly on Facebook multimedia that when somebody makes a post or puts a post out there on something they have in their belief system, it sometimes comes under scrutiny by others. If you think I'm kidding, you just go home today on your Facebook account and you post this: Paul never confessed any sins after his conversion.
Amen.
And you see what happens. You'll be the subject of many criticisms and questions. Are you put out there, now this, I know this is one of your favorites, but I'm going to use it today. Oh, I forgot, you gave me some good stuff to use this morning, didn't you? Yeah. You put this out there: the sinner's prayer is not found in the Bible.
Yeah.
And then you sit back and expect for criticism to come at you.
Yeah.
This is my favorite. Put out there, there's no such thing as praying through.
Mm-hmm.
As a 16-year-old boy, I was always wondering, what did that really mean? I really did wonder about that. If you have to pray through, this means that there are some hoops to jump through.
Yeah.
There's a maze for you to wander around until you find the right path to get out.
Yeah.
There are things that you're going to have to promise God that you will give up to get him to save you. There are promises that you're going to have to do for God if he will just have mercy on you. This is about praying through. And whatever else all that means. There are no prayers like that found in the scripture pertaining to praying through. I'm sorry, dear pastor, preacher, friends of mine that may be watching, but if you're telling people to come to the altar and pray through, you're misleading them and you're misguiding them.
Amen.
Here's something for you to consider. When Jesus seen Matthew, he said, "Follow me." Matthew dropped what he was doing and he followed Jesus. When Philip preached Jesus to the Ethiopian eunuch, he wanted to be baptized, and Philip asked him, "Do you believe?" His response was, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God."
Yes.
When John the Baptist identified Jesus as the Lamb of God, two of John's disciples followed Jesus, and he said unto them, "What are you seeking?" They said unto him, "Rabbi," which is interpreted, "Master, where are you dwelling?" And Jesus said, "Come and see."
Yes. They dwelt with him, and one of them was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. And he went and found Peter and said, "We found the Messiah." And he brought him to Jesus, and Jesus looked at Peter and said, "You'll be called Cephas," meaning a stone. The point is, Andrew went to get Peter. Peter believed what Andrew said, that Jesus was who he was, and so he came to meet Jesus. And you know what? It's the exact same thing today. I'm proclaiming that Jesus Christ is the very Son of God. People hear that message. The Holy Spirit opens their heart and says, "This is truth." Man becomes a believer. Man is not a praying through-er. Man becomes a believer from the heart, amen. It's about believing, ladies and gentlemen. And I know that kind of goes against the grain with a lot of people. Well, I'm sorry, but you just need to simply believe, amen, who Jesus is, and tell others who are lost to believe upon the Son of God. Don't confuse them with say this and say that and pray through and tell God you're sorry and that you'll give up and if he'll just do this. Don't lead them down that path. Can't say it enough today. And finally, the next day, Jesus found Philip and said, "Follow me." And he did. There's no sinner's prayer found in these scriptural instances, but what we do find is belief in every story. Do you see why the Pharisees were upset? People are getting redeemed without keeping a law or doing a sacrifice. Satan is upset today because poor lost sinners get saved by believing upon the Son of God. You see, Satan wants people to get busy. If I could just stop smoking, if I could just stop drinking, if I could just stop cussing, if I could just get adultery out of my life, if I could just quit fornicating, if I could just. You know how come Satan got cast out of heaven? There's five reasons he said, "I will," over in the book of Isaiah. He was very prideful and filled with pride. People get filled with pride when they think they've finally accomplished an "I will." Yeah. Amen? And what you need to do is just look to the cross of Calvary today and trust him and know that he resurrected the life for you to give you life today. Amen? Satan gets upset when a believer finally sees the value of the gospel of grace teaching. When a believer gets freed from a law-based way of living by performances and they truly understand what Jesus meant by him giving life more abundantly. Oh, it's a good thing, dear friend, for us to go after the Lord. Amen? It's a good thing to go after him. And that's the first step to freedom. These Jews, they were under law and could never be freed from sin. Sin was always remembered year by year. But in Jesus, all sin once for all was forgiven and remembered no more. Amen? The resurrection is the basis of going after Jesus. When Jesus went to the cross, our sins were forgiven. When Jesus went to the cross, it was once for all. When Jesus went to the cross, every law and sacrifice was met in Jesus, and nothing was left undone. He said, "It is finished," and it is. Amen? But life came through the resurrection. Jesus said to Martha in John 11 at the tomb of Lazarus, "I am the resurrection and the life, and he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." Paul said in Colossians 2, "Having been buried with him in baptism, in which you are also raised up with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead, when you were dead in your transgressions and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions." Amen? These Jews in John 12, they recognized that going after Jesus meant to find life in him, as they seen the evidence right before their very eyes of a man who was officially declared dead, but had now been raised to life again by Jesus. Today, for those of us who have believed on the only begotten Son of God, we were once dead, but now we've been crucified with Jesus. We were once dead, and we have been buried with Jesus. We were once dead, but now we have been resurrected with Jesus. And now, living inside of us is the resurrected life of Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God. There was a day I bowed my heart, and I went after him. I've gone after him. I hope you see what these Jews saw. We should be going after Jesus to Calvary. And that means that our sins are gone once for all. Going after Jesus' resurrection means that we've obtained eternal life in Him. Going after Jesus is to be free from a law-based spiritual life of living in defeat. Going after Jesus means others will be influenced to go after Him as well. What are you talking about, Preacher Tim? If you go down to John chapter 12, verses 20 through 22, you'll see what I'm talking about. And there were certain Greeks. Who were these people? They were you and me. They're Gentiles. There were certain Gentiles among them that came up to worship at the feast. That same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida, of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we'd like to see Jesus. Philip comes and tells Andrew, and Andrew and Philip, they tell Jesus, there's some folks here wanting to see you. And you know what happened? He did. I think the message here today is that Jesus gives life to all that have come to Him, dear friend. He raised Lazarus back to life, and the Jews interpreted that to mean that Jesus had power to raise them up in the last day. I hope that you have that faith today. If you're a believer, you must have that faith today to believe that He could raise you from the dead. And He can. If you're not a believer, I hope that you'll come to Him right now believing who He said that He is. If you're born again, I hope you see what an abundant life that you are able to have. Amen? Yes. Living an abundant life in Jesus. We need to keep our focus on where it needs to be. It is upon the resurrected Jesus Christ, not ourselves.
Amen.
Brother, there was nothing. We were helpless. We could not save ourselves when we were lost. That's just how it was. We were undone. We were weak. We had no faith. But He came and gave us faith. And we looked to Him one day and said, Lord, I abandon myself to You, believing that He is who He said He is and that He did what He said He would do, take away the sin of the world. And then when He was buried, He rose from the dead, and we believe that story in our hearts, and we've received the gift of eternal life. Brother, that's a beautiful story. That's a beautiful story to tell. And I think when people who are hungry and thirsting in this life, looking for the answer of life, and we tell them our story, it's about this man named Jesus who is the giver of life, a resurrected life. People want that. And we have that opportunity. Amen? Let's bow our hearts today. Let's pray. Let's have a song. Miss Reba and Brother Ray. Heavenly Father, Lord, whichever case I'm speaking to today, whether it's a believer or if it's a lost, poor lost sinner, I pray that we would go after Jesus today. Oh, Lord, thank You for this story. The Jews, they went after Him. The Pharisees were upset. We know that our enemy gets upset today when we go after and we seek after You, Father. Lord, I'm glad You didn't make it hard. I'm glad, Lord, that it is as easy as believing and trusting in who You say that You are, Jesus. Knowing what You've done for us on the cross, You've taken away our sin, You sent it away. It's performed once and for all. It is finished. There's nothing left undone. There's nothing else to do. There's nothing we can ever do. It's what You did. And Lord, I'm so thankful that You rose from the dead by the power of God. And I pray if there's anybody listening today that's lost, I pray that they would simply bow their heart and say, Jesus, I believe that You are the Son of God. I believe You died for me. I believe that You were buried, and I believe that You rose from the dead by the power of God. And I accept You now as my Lord and my Savior, my Redeemer. Father, I thank You for that today, and I pray for believers that may be walking around in spiritual bondage today, trying to perform and trying to do better every day, Lord, and they keep having disappointment because they continue to fail, and they come down on themselves, and of course the enemy is right there whispering in their ear, telling them what a loser that they are. But God, we're not losers. We're children of God. We're born of You. And I pray, Father, today that all believers would just look to You today and follow after You. Thank You, Father. Bless this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand to our feet. Let's sing the song this morning. Christ is all I need. That is true. Let's sing.
Christ is all I need. Christ is all